please.
Thank you for the introduction. Hi everyone, my name is Rui Fernandes. I'm a PhD student at the University of Coimbra, and I'm going to present the work effect of the treatment on the fatigue crack growth performance of aluminium, silicon 10 magnesium alloy submitted to laser powder bed fusion. So this is the outline of the work and the topics that I will address after. So regarding additive manufacturing, it's a process based on 3D CAD files that enables the production of complex shapes and ensuring waste reduction when compared to the traditional methods. Within additive manufacturing, we have the laser powder bed fusion that allows the use of metallic powders, and it was the process used to produce our components. However, this process is characterized by the introduction of some defects like porosity, lack of fusion, residual stress, or rugged surfaces that could have a major impact in the fatigue life of the components. Here, I want to draw the attention to the residual stress. And regarding this, the main sellers of the technology recommend applying stress relief at 300 degrees or T6 heat treatments. But as it's possible to see here, this is the as-built material, this is the stress relief at 300 degrees, and this is the T6 heat treatments. The results show that the application of these heat treatments compromise the mechanical properties of this alloy. And then Mr. Fiocchi has identified a temperature range which introduced some microstructural changes that are responsible for the high degrees of the mechanical properties. And he found that temperatures higher than 260 degrees will lead to the precipitation of the silicon with its aggregation that takes to the disappearance of the aluminium silicon network, as we see here. This is as built material, and here we have the aggregation of the silicon particles. So the main goal of this work was to study the crack propagation of non-standard heat treatments, and to do that we have produced the samples in a Renishaw AM400 machine with the chemical composition and the parameters that are shown in these two tables. Regarding the heat treatments that we use, we choose a stress relief with, let's say, non-standard, because we change a little the temperature. We select a temperature below the 260, so we choose the 250, it was for 2 hours, followed by water caching. And we also choose the heat treatment with the same temperature, but with a pressure of 100 megapascal. Regarding the fatigue tests, they were done using a 10 kN capacity Instron electrolysis equipment with two different stress ratios. The crack length was measured through the traveling microscope in increments of 0.2 millimeters, and the crack growth rates were determined by the incremental polynomial method using 5 consecutive points. The tests were performed in low control with a sinusoidal wave at 10 Hz, and the displacements were acquired by DIG technology, and the crack closure is expressed using the U parameter as in the formula. So Here we have some micrography of the as-built specimen, and is mainly composed by a supersaturated aluminium silicon cellular dendritic microstructure. And as it's possible to see, we have four different zones. Here we have the inside of the melt pool with a fine cellular microstructure. Then we have here we have the boundary between two melt pools with a cellular coarse microstructure that is similar to this one, but this one changed a little bit because of the it's a reheating zone during the process. Finally, we have the fourth zone, which is a dendritic columnar substructure due to the solidification direction from the inside to the outside of the melt. Sorry. Here we have a same micrography from the hip specimen. Sorry, I see that it's an error here. But the major difference that we could find is that the heat treatments induce a more homogenized microstructure by coarsening the aluminium silicon network. In this figure, it's also possible to notice that some zones where in these zones the network begins to disappear due to the precipitation of the silicon. This figure is also representative of the stress relief specimen. The ADX analysis shows that the aluminium is spread along the matrix and the silicon is mainly in the network zone. Here we have the same similar geometry. Regarding the hardness results, it's possible to observe that when the heat treatment was applied, the hardness is decreased. And when we see, when we compare between series, the heap series has a reduction of 30%, and the stress relief has a reduction of 31%. These results are similar with the monotonic tests because the heat treatment series has a decrease in the mechanical properties. In terms of ultimate strength, tensile strength, we have a decrease of 10% for the heap series, and for the stress relief we have a decrease of 13%. However, we reach higher values of elongation. So when we see these results, we could say that the heat treatment have a bad impact in the mechanical properties of the specimens. But let's see the fatigue propagation tests. This is the results for the first stress ratio, where the as-built material has higher values of the ADN, and the heap and the stress reliefs have similar values in regime 2, showing a higher fatigue resistance. Regarding the second stress ratio that we used, the results are similar with the ones that I showed before, with the as-built specimens reaching higher values of the ADN. The difference between heap and stress relief has increased for higher values of delta K. When we compare the different stress ratios used in this work, it's possible to notice that for the three cases, there are no significant influence of the stress ratio, and these results are in agreement with the crack closure levels that I will show before, that I will show after, sorry. These values of parameter is for the first stress ratio that I show, and it's possible to understand that there is no significant crack closure levels for the three series. This is for the results for the U value for the second stress ratio, and we could see that there is no crack closure at all. So, what are the conclusions of this work? The application of the treatment has an impact in the coarsening of the characteristic aluminium silicon network, but there is no generalized precipitation of the silicon. This coarsening contributes to the decrease in the mechanical properties as hardness or monotonic behavior. And regarding the fatigue propagation tests, the Esbul specimen has higher values of crack propagation when compared to the treat samples. However, the heat do not show a better performance than the stress relief in the crack propagation tests. The stress ratio shows no influence on the crack propagation of the three series, and these results are in agreement with the results of the crack closure levels. So, to completely address the subject of this work, we will do a residual stress analysis to can understand what influenced the difference in the fatigue crack propagation. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
Thanks for your presentation. You did say you saw no effect of stress ratio, is that right?
Yes.
Is your both stress ratios were tension-tension, like positive?
Yes.
Okay, I think that's the reason you don't see any effect, because you don't open the pore much or the defects much. Okay. If you do a tension compression or R equal to minus 1, which we did, you will definitely see some effects. So that's a suggestion.
Okay.
For you to consider, because it may be true as well. So I think you have to check the negative stress ratio as well.
Thank you for your
thank you.
Sharing.
Thank you very much. Other question? No one?